Nobody plays live poker because they enjoy doing math, let alone math in front of other people. But if you're going to spend the time to put pants on, put deodorant on, put gas in the car, drive someplace, park in a shady parking lot most likely, and then talk to people you don't really want to talk to, you might as well, at the end of the day, make a little bit more money while doing so. And a little bit of math can make you a lot more money in the long run. So let's make sure you understand these concepts today. I'll explain them, break them down for you, give you some examples. And while you may not be able to calculate them perfectly at the table, a little bit of knowledge here and a little bit of practice can go a long, long way towards your win rate. So let's get into it and get started. Good morning. How are we doing today? My name is James Sweeney, aka Split Suit. I'm a poker player, coach, and author, and I've been around this game for a couple decades now. And I know players don't love math. People in general don't love to do math, or maths if you're in the UK, but it's still extremely important. And honestly, poker at the end of the day is a math game. I know a lot of players want to turn this into this is a feel thing. I just have to feel out my bluffs. And honestly, for most players, that's a huge justification, rationalization for not learning the math. But the thing you need to understand is that poker math is not that complicated. Once you know what to look for, what to prioritize in terms of calculations, and you do a little bit of practice, this stuff gets much, much easier. And this is true whether you play live or online. And today we're going to talk about some live things that you 100% need to be paying attention to. And these, I think, are some of the most important ones. And we're just going to go through four of them. Let's get started. Kicking it off with number one, which is auto profit. And this is one of the biggest things that I focus on in real time when I'm trying to find bluffs or extra plays. And if you are looking to add more bluffs into your playbook as well, this is the first place you want to start. So the concept is very simple. If your opponent is folding more often than the break-even percentage, your play is auto-profitable, meaning that you can fire with any two cards and print profit. And this, of course, is very, very good when you're bluffing with nonsense or even semi-bluffing. The more your opponent is folding, based upon the required fold percentage, the more and more profitable it is for you, and as such, the more and more bluffs you want to be making in that particular spot. Now, if all of that sounded a little over the top for you, let's break it down very simply. Again, it's auto-profitable if your opponent folds more often than the break-even percentage. So we have to know the break-even percentage. If you've never worked with this before, it is extremely simple. It is risk divided by risk plus reward. And if you're new to that, make sure to memorize that. In fact, why don't you go down in the comments right now and just pop that in there. Risk divided by risk plus reward. Please, just memorize that. It goes a very, very long way in this game. So the risk is how much you are betting for or considering betting or raising for, and the reward is what you're fighting for right that moment, or the pot size. And I created a very simple tool for this. I'll leave a link for it in the description box if you want to grab it, but it is extremely, extremely helpful. And you just plug in, again, those two basic numbers and you get your break-even percentage. So let's just take a bare bones basic spot where the pot is $600 and you're considering firing a $600 bet. Well, again, risk divided by risk plus reward, 600 divided by 1200 equals 50%. So if your opponent is folding more than 50%, that is auto profitable. You could fire with complete garbage and nonsense and make an auto profit in that spot. That is pretty, pretty awesome and very, very important. Now, for whatever reason in this spot, you think your opponent's actually going to fold in this spot 75% of the time. So again, 75% is higher than 50%, and as such, this is auto profitable. Great. So again, fire with any two cards, no problem. Now, don't get me wrong. If you're newer to poker in general, this could seem a little complicated, especially if you haven't messed around with tools like Flopzilla Pro. You might not really have an idea on how often your opponent may or may not fold. But as a general rule, if you're talking about a tighter player on the turn or river, even in live games where a lot of players get a lot stickier, tighter players tend to get very, very nitty on turns and rivers, especially as your bet size starts getting larger and larger. So if you look at this formula, if we throw in a bigger and bigger bet, even over bets, we do need our opponent to fold more often. But if by going just a little bit bigger in your bet or raise size is going to create a ton of extra folds from your opponent, again, it's easy to find some extra auto profit spots, just mathematically speaking, looking at this. And you do have to make some general assumptions on your opponent, how often they might fold, and thinking about their folding frequency as it relates to your bet size, right? Again, if you go smaller, they're likely going to fold less. If you go bigger, they likely continue less often as well. So you you can go from there and make some general decisions, but this is how you can use this overall model to start finding more spots. And if you practice with this stuff between sessions, I promise you, you're going to be able to find an extra spot or two in every session you play, even if it's just a pre-flop 3-bet, or if it's a gin, a turn barrel, or if it's a river bluff. These are prime spots, and if you use auto profit and you're focusing on that a lot of the time, you're going to find more spots to be able to profitably bluff rather than just panicking of, ah, I have error again, I missed, whatever, and now I don't want to do anything, or I'm panicking. Because again, if you're focused on auto profit, you might be able to turn that complete error, that whiff, draw, whatever, into actual profit. And for what it's worth, if you're panicking about being really, really precise in these calculations, I would panic much, much less about that. So just to take a basic spot where you're on the turn in a given spot and you decide to barrel 75 into a $97 pot. Well, the $97, could we just round that up to 100? And if we did that and plug that into the calculator, what happens in that exact situation? Throw that in, break even of 44%. If we change the reward to 100, again, just rounding that number, it's 43% on the break even. So it's not really changing things a tremendous amount. So don't really panic if you're a couple bucks off, plus or minus. Again, if you're in the ballpark, is there much of a functional difference for you if it's 42.5% versus 43.6%? Not really at the end of the day. So don't panic about being absolutely precise. Being in the ballpark is going to be fine. And also, you're going to figure out the patterns very, very quickly when it comes to saying, okay, what percentage of pot am I thinking about betting in this spot? And you will memorize the auto profit numbers very, very quickly. The good thing is, if you work through exercises like in my new live poker workbook, that you're going to go through spots like this where you're not only going to get reps with calculating the break-even percentage, again, to find those patterns very easily, but also run through some different stuff with Flopzilla. My opponent continues with this tight of a range, what is the folding frequency? If they continue with a much wider range, again, how often are they folding? So you can get some extra reps and be able to make these kind of assumptions and estimations in real time even better. And I promise you, at the end of the day, it's going to help you find a bunch of extra bluffs in the long run. All right, moving on to concept number two, and that is multi-way bluffing. And this ties right back to auto profit and break-even percentage. But this is something that is really important since live games have a tremendous amount of multi-way pots, especially compared to online cash games, and you have to get comfortable and familiar in these spots. Now, from a theory perspective, you typically bluff a lot less in multi-way pots, and some players take this to the extreme and pretty much never bluff in a multi-way live pot. And I get that, but if you never ever bluff, that's going to be problematic for a multitude of reasons. But if nothing else, there are profitable bluffs to make in these pots. Of course, these spots can be a little bit more complicated since there are even more factors at play, not just one opponent, but now multiple. But still, this is very, very helpful for, again, doing the basic calculations and being able to say, hey, this could be a spot where I could bluff a lot more. So instead of just constantly checking with that error or that semi-bluff, you might end up firing it at a higher frequency and, again, finding some profit along the way. Now, the underlying math for break-even percentage is the exact same. Risk divided by risk plus reward. Doesn't matter if you have one opponent in the pot or 50 opponents in the pot, exact same number can get calculated, again, based upon the size of the bet or raise you're considering making. However, the big thing that does differ is how often your opponents are going to fold. When there's one opponent, you just say, okay, I think they're going to fold that often, and you work from there. Very simple. However, if you have multiple opponents, let's just say two of them, the thing you have to do is multiply those folding frequencies together to get an overall idea on how often everybody is going to fold. When you're bluffing, that's what you care about. How often is everybody going to fold to you and allow you to pick up the pot uncontested? They fold too often, given your bet size, awesome. If they don't, well, again, we can consider other things, but this at least is the starting point for it. So if you have a spot where you're against two other players, one is going to fold 60% of the time, you think the other is going to fold 50% of the time, multiply those two numbers together for a 30% output. So again, if your opponents are folding more often than the break-even percentage, cool. If not, then obviously probably not a great auto-profitable bluff for you. Now, some of the big things you'll notice as you practice some of these calculations between sessions is you're going to start noticing that if one person is folding very rarely, it's extremely difficult, if not almost impossible, to find a auto profit bluff in those spots. And of course, if they're folding very rarely, chances are they're fishy and you're probably not bluffing a ton against fish anyway, so that's all totally well and good. So keep that in mind. And number two is to keep in mind that this is a little bit more of a rough estimate. So there are spots where you think, okay, I think my opponent's going to fold 60% of the time here, but in a spot where the first person continues and then it it's their action, they might actually continue a little bit wider than that, which of course means they're folding less often. So you're taking kind of a rough average look at the overall branches available when you actually make your bluff. So keep that in mind. If you find spots that are extremely close, okay, maybe you're not taking as many bluffs, but you can still find plenty of spots, especially on turns, where you can leverage larger sizing and generate a tremendous amount of folds from kind of the non-fishy side of the spectrum, even in multi-way pots. So again, by constantly training your brain to make these calculations, focus on this, and not just say, hey, I have air in a multi-way pot, I'm never going to fire here, this again can help you find some extra plus EV plays. May not come up a tremendous amount per session, but at least if you can be aware of them and looking for them, it can help you at the end of the day. All right, moving on to math concept number three that all live poker players need to understand and be calculating, and that is simply combos. So essentially, combos are counting how many different ways a particular hand can be made. And blockers look at, okay, based upon the visible cards that we have, either our whole cards or the community cards, how many ways our opponent can make that hand, again, based upon the reduction, the blockers that we currently see. So this is a very important concept, and I get asked a lot, like, how often should we be calculating combos? Does it come up a tremendous amount even in live play? And the truth of the matter is that I think it is very important, and you're rarely going to be combo specific in real time, but if you can start training your brain to look for and calculate combos and just kind of keep a rough count, it will go a tremendous amount of the way, especially towards finding bluffs, but even when it comes to finding value as well. Now, in No Limit Hold'em, you can only have one of three different starting hand types. You can have a pocket pair, like pocket sixes. You can have an unpaired starting hand, and unpaired starting hands can either be suited or unsuited. That is literally all you can possibly have if you've never thought about it like that before. And the combo counts are very, very simple for them. For a pocket pair, it is 6. For an unpaired starting hand, it is 16. 4 of those being suited, 12 of them being unsuited. Very, very simple. But there are a couple of things that I would definitely prioritize focusing on if you're not already. The first is counting the combos of pocket pairs, and to do this, we can use the 6-3-1-0 rule. I know, not the sexiest name in the world, but it gets the job done. You'll see why in a moment. So let's just say you have ace-king in your hand, and you're trying to figure out how many combos of pocket queens your opponent could have. Well, you don't see any queens, and as such, it is 6. There are 6 possible starting combos for pocket queens. Let's say that there is 1 queen on board. Well, now you're in a situation where you use the 3. There's, again, 1 visible queen, and if your opponent does have pocket queens, there are only 3 possible combos to make that. If you see 2 of the queens, let's just say the turn is a queen as well, now all of a sudden you're in a situation where there is exactly 1 combo of pocket queens your opponent can have. If the 3rd queen shows up on the river, it is now impossible for your opponent to have pocket queens. That would mean there are 5 in the deck, and that's impossible. So as such, again, 6-3-1-0 based upon how many of them you see. Whether the card is visible on the community cards or it's in your whole card, either way, that is what you would be looking for again, quickly being able to count the number of pocket pairs that your opponent or any person might be holding. The next thing I focus on are counting top pair combinations. Now, when it comes to an unpaired starting hand, again, there are 16 possible of them, and to figure out how many are remaining, we can just simply multiply unseen cards by unseen cards. So let's just say we're in a spot, we have pocket kings, an ace pops up on the flop, and we're trying to figure out how often our opponent could have top pair. Let's just say with something like ace jack. Well, there is 1 visible ace, so we have 4 in the deck minus 1 that we see, so 3. There are still 4 remaining jacks that we do not see at all, so we take 3 times 4 to give us 12 possible combos of top pair of ace jack. Very, very simple, and then you can run that same thing if you think your opponent would call preflop with ace 10 through ace king. Again, you can go forward from there. Now, take the same spot where we have ace-king as well, and we're trying to figure out how many combos of ace-king our opponent might have. Again, there are 3 unseen aces. There are 2 unseen kings since we have 2 in our hand. 3 times 2 is 6. So again, 6 combinations of ace-king that our opponent may possibly have. And the third thing I'm keeping a lot of track of in real time is counting the nutted combos that my opponent may have. Now, of course, this is going to be very complex, especially as your opponent's range gets really, really wide and you're thinking about what you kind of considered as nuttish. But at least if you're in the ballpark and you're trying to keep a combo count, it's going to help a tremendous amount as opposed to just ignoring it altogether, even though it might be a little complicated, especially at first if you've never really done this. You know, this is a lot of stuff, again, you build between sessions by doing practice, and that way in real time, you're a lot closer. Not saying you're going to be combo precise, but at least you can be in the ballpark. That helps a lot. So counting nutted combos is pretty much going to be a merge of the two calculations we just did, using the 6-3-1-0 rule for figuring out pocket pairs, again very, very helpful for figuring out sets and how many your opponent may or may not have, and then also the unpaired stuff, so looking at like top pairs or two pairs or stuff like that that your opponent may or may not have. So again, if you kind of just keep a general count for two pair plus, that's usually pretty darn good. On rivers, maybe that starts to go more towards set plus, but at least you're in the ballpark for being able to say, hey, roughly how many combos do I think my opponent has of this? And if they play really aggressive and there's just not a ton of nutted combos that they would realistically have in that spot, well, cool. Chances are you can hero call them more liberally, maybe bluff raise if you want to, but you have these different options available if at least you're constantly counting them and thinking about the count of nutted combos or nut-ish combos compared to their overall betting or aggressive range. Again, something that can be a little complicated, but is 100% worth the time and effort, and again, off-table practice that goes into it. And the fourth concept you should 100% be paying attention to in a live cash game is thinking about pot geometry. Now, pot geometry looks at what every dollar put or not put into a pot is going to do to the final pot size. So if you obviously are betting much larger on earlier streets, if you do that consistently and you keep getting called, it's going to be a much larger overall pot size than if, say, you bet 1/3 pot on every single street and continued getting called. So, of course, that's pretty obvious, but what's the difference between betting, say, 50% pot on every street and betting 75% pot on every single street? May seem like it's not a huge difference, but if you work with pot geometry between sessions, you can definitely get a much more precise answer to that, and in real time be paying attention to what is the final pot size I'm creating and is that in alignment with the goals that I have for my particular hand. Obviously, with a stronger hand, you'd like to build the biggest pot possible. With a weaker hand, well, hopefully you don't have to get to showdown with that one. But again, this will help you start thinking about setting up pots that are appropriate for your hand and the goals you have with that hand. Rather than turn this into a very long example, I actually did a video quite recently on pot geometry, and I'm going to actually link that right up there in that card. Make sure to watch that next if you want to go a step further and figure out how to work with this concept a little bit more. Again, practicing with it between sessions, and it does use the new live cash game workbook, so I would highly suggest checking that out if you haven't already. But I think that's a good place to put a pin in it for this video. Again, these concepts take a little bit of time off-table practice, but the more you work with it between sessions, the easier it is to train your brain to actually be focused on these things in real time, so that way you can find more bluffs, you can build the pots you're looking to build, you can choose bet sizes that are in alignment with the goals that you have, and trust me, at the end of the day, it's going to make your life not just easier, but also more profitable. I know math isn't everyone's favorite thing to do, but this is a math game at the end of the day, and a little bit of time and effort goes a long, long way. But anyway, thank you so much for hanging out today. Hopefully you enjoyed. If you need anything, don't hesitate to let me know. Otherwise, I'll see you back shortly with a brand new video. In the meantime, good luck out there and happy grinding.